Sister Leslie, remember to give me a signal for the one minute left. Good morning and welcome to the River of Life online worship experience. We are so excited to have you today. We're excited to be able to worship with you online another week. For this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is a special day. Not only are we able to worship together, but we're able to celebrate the River of Life second year anniversary. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So as you come in, we welcome you. We welcome you. If you will, please do so. Share this live online worship experience. All you have to do is click the share button. Amen. So others can come in and worship with us. And when you hit the share button, you should see on your screen, it should say watch party. We ask that you click on watch party, that others who may not be on our friend list will still be able to worship with us. Amen. We're excited to worship today. Just a few tips. If you can, just sit closer to the television. Sit closer. Sit up. Make yourself available for worship. Make yourself available, amen, for praise. Make yourself available, amen, for the word of God today. And we just want you, amen, to just be a part of this service. Welcome others as they come in. Say hi. Introduce yourself. Announce where you're viewing from so we can welcome you to our online worship experience. We ask that you sing along, sing loud, get out of your comfort area and begin to just worship with us. If you have to stretch, amen, if you have to sing loud, whatever you have to do, let's engage in today's worship. We're excited about what God is getting ready to do. And at this time, we will go into prayer. Ask that wherever you are, you will open up your heart for prayer. Oh God, we tell you thank you today. God, we tell you thank you, God, for your loving kindness. God, we thank you, God, for being a God who's in control of our lives. God, we just ask, God, today, Lord God, that you will just have your way. Have your way, Lord God. We ask that you will move, oh Father God, even through this live worship experience, Lord God. We ask that your anointing, oh God, would penetrate the homes and the hearts of your people, Lord God. We pray in the name of Jesus, oh Lord God, that people will be encouraged. They will be uplifted, Lord God. They will be strengthened, Lord God. Oh God, we come today, Lord God, to let the enemy know that he has not taken our praise. We let fear know that it's defeated. It's under our feet today, oh God. And we come, Lord God, to exalt you and to magnify your holy name today. Oh Lord God, we just ask, Lord God, that people, oh God, will gather in. They will gather in, Lord God, today. And God, they will join us in worship. They will join us in the word, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. If someone is down, if someone is downtrodden, Lord God, if someone is depressed, God, someone may be discouraged, Lord God, we pray that something will be sung today. Something will be said in the word today, oh Lord God, to give them strength to run on and see what the end will be. Lord God, we come with gladness in our hearts. We come with thanksgiving on our tongues, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, you are our everything, and we worship you today, Father. Oh God, we ask that you will go into every home, every heart, every mind, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. And God, we count it all joy, oh God, for this too will pass. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Come on and give God your best praise. Come on, if you're online today, come on, just say hallelujah. Say amen. Wherever you are, just give God your best praise. Come on, we want you to utilize those hearts today. We want you to utilize your emojis today. We just want you to have a good time online today with us today as we worship and we sing that God is our everything. Hallelujah. God is our everything. We come to celebrate. And we come to give God our best praise today. Come on. Come on. Put those hands together. We're going to have some church today. Come on. Come on. Come on. We come to say that God is our everything. Come on. Just type in. God is my everything. Say God is my everything. Oh, say he's my joy in sorrow. Come on, y'all. Say he's my hope for tomorrow. Hey, he is my rock in a weary land. Hey, he is the shelter. Hey, say God is. Come on, is that your testimony today? Come on, just say God is my everything. Yes, let's say it again. Say God is my everything. We come to lift your name, God. My everything. Come on, I don't care where you at. Just clap your hands. He's my joy. Come on, get out your bed and say he's my hope for tomorrow. Hey, say he's my rock in the weary land. Come on, turn me up. Oh, shelter. Hey, say God is. Say God is my everything. We're going to say it one more time because somebody didn't feel it. Hey, say God is my everything. I feel it in my feet this morning. God is my everything. Hey, he is my joy and sorrow. Come on, y'all, let's have some church. He's my hope for tomorrow. Yes, he is my rock in the weary land. Found him to be a shelter. Yeah, God is. Say God is. Say God is. Whatever you need him to be. He's the Prince of Peace. He's my everything. He's the King of Kings. I found him to be Jehovah Jireh. My provider. Say my God is. Do you believe that he is? Come on. Just type in God is. And type in whatever he is to you. Hey, God is. Oh, yes, he is. God is. Oh, he is. Hey. Come on, let's go to church right here. Yes, my everything. Say, can I get a witness? Come on, put those hands together. Come on. Come on, I dare you to say he. Come on, somebody put my everything. My everything. He's my joy and sorrow. My hope for tomorrow. Hey, where can I go? When the storm is raging. Say, where can I go? When the billows begin to roll. Somebody say my everything. My everything. Say, won't God do it? Say, won't God bless it? Say, won't God turn it? Say, won't God work it? Won't God work it out? Won't God work your favor? Somebody say, my everything. My everything. I love to give him glory. I love to give him praise. Oh, my everything. I love to praise him. He'll never let me fall. He'll never let me down. He'll never let me fall. Put those hands together. Put those hands together. Come on. Put those hands together. Hey, God is. Say God is. Say God is. Everything. I feel a replay. I feel a replay in my spirit. I feel a replay in my spirit. Take me back, y'all.
My everything.
Come on, put those hands on it. Come on.
My everything.
My everything. Come on, y'all thought it was over. Come on.
My everything.
My everything.
My everything.
Won't he open doors?
My everything.
Won't he provide for you?
My everything.
Won't he keep your mind
my everything.
In perfect peace?
My everything.
Say my everything.
My everything.
My everything.
My everything.
Won't he make a way? Won't he open doors? Won't he keep your mind? Won't he keep your mind? Won't he provide for you? He'll never let me down. He'll never let me fall. All I had to do was call him. All I had to do was call him. Somebody say Jesus.
I am victory.
Somebody say Jesus.
I am victory.
Somebody say Jesus.
I am
my everything.
I am
my everything.
I am
my everything.
I am
my everything.
I am.
Put those hands on it. Come on, y'all find a place to worship. Come on, find you a place to dance. Come on. That feel good to me this morning. Come on. Say God is. Say God is my everything. Come on. Come on. Hallelujah. He's our everything. And because he's our everything, we sing that there shall be glory after this. Amen. This too shall pass. Somebody type in, this too shall pass. Come on. Come on, somebody put in, there shall be glory after this. Come on. There will be glory. Come on, there will be glory.
There will be victory after this.
Hey, say God will turn it around.
God will turn it around.
Say he will.
He will bring.
He'll bring us out.
There will be glory after this.
Come on, y'all put it out. There will be glory. Come on.
There will be
glory. Come on, y'all put some hearts on the screen. Come on. There will be victory.
There will be victory after this.
Oh, oh, he will.
God will turn it around.
There he will.
He will bring you out.
Oh, there will
be glory after this.
Come on, somebody say God specializes.
God specializes.
In things impossible.
In things impossible.
Oh, he loves to move. When all hope is gone, just so that he can show,
ground
on your behalf. Somebody say, don't give up. Oh, he'll come through for you. Come on, there will be glory.
Hey,
come on, somebody say, this too shall pass. There will be victory. Hey, say God will turn it around.
God will turn it around.
Say
he will. He will bring you.
Oh, out.
There will be.
There will be
glory.
There will be.
There will be glory.
Whatever you're going through,
there will be glory.
It won't compare to the glory of God in your life. Come on, come on, come on. Come on and give God some praise. If you believe that there shall be glory after this. Hallelujah. We still will praise him after this. We still will give him honor after this.
There will be a praise.
Somebody say after this.
After this.
There will be joy.
There will be joy.
Somebody say after this.
After this.
There'll be a testimony.
There'll be a testimony.
Say after this.
There will be glory.
Somebody say after this.
After this.
There will be a praise. Somebody say after this.
After this.
Trouble don't last always.
There will be joy.
And it's all you have.
After this.
The world is living to me.
There'll be a testimony.
There'll be a testimony. And there'll be glory. Come on, somebody say trouble don't last always. I'm so glad that trouble don't last always. There will be glory after this. Come on and give God praise. Somebody put on the screen, there will be glory. There will be glory after this. There will be glory after this. We're excited. We're excited about what God is doing. For God is doing a new thing. God is doing a new thing. Somebody say new thing. Somebody put on the screen new thing. God is doing a new thing. And God, whatever you're doing in this season, our prayer is, God, that you don't do it without us. Amen. God, we thank you for 2 years. We thank you for 2 years, Lord God, with the River of Life Fellowship. God, you're doing amazing and wonderful things through our pastor, Pastor Shazier, and through this ministry, Lord God. And we just give you honor and we give you praise. And God, we say thank you. And we just want to welcome you. We say welcome to our friends, our guests, our brothers and sisters. And I just want to take this opportunity to thank you for being a part of our worship experience. It is wonderful always to have you to join us on our live worship experience. We trust that the worship and the message today will uplift and encourage you as you share together in this fellowship moment today. May your burdens be lifted. May you feel comforted. And as the Lord reveals his plan and purpose in your life, may you be inspired and encouraged through the presence of God to continue to trust God and the power that's in you to defeat every fear. The church is not closed today, for we are open. We are the church and we are alive because Jesus Christ, he lives through us. And we say welcome, welcome, welcome. And we ask again that you share this live worship experience. And we ask that when you hit the share button, that you will click on where it says watch party, that others may join in this worship experience with us. Amen. Each week, invite, share. And you don't have to just share today's worship experience. Amen. But all week long, you can share the worship experience from this day and from weeks before. But we want to say welcome. I'm excited and I'm glad to be able to worship the living God with you, my friends, today. Hallelujah. This morning, we want to take your attention to Psalms 56, verses 1 through 3, for that is our scripture reading for today. Psalms 56, 1, first through the third verse, and it says, be gracious to me, O God, for man tramples on me all day long. An attacker oppresses me. My enemies trample on me all day long, for many attack me proudly. When I'm afraid, I put my trust in you. Somebody just type in the screen, I put my trust in you. I put my trust in you. That's our scripture reading for today. And the word of God is already blessed. Amen. We're going to prepare our hearts to receive the word of God today. And the next song will be, I will trust you. I will trust in you, Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, if you trust God, we defeat fear today and we trust God today.
You did not create me to worry. You did not create me to fear. But you created me to worship daily, so I will leave it all right here.
You did not create me to worry.
Oh, God.
You did not create me to fear.
But you created me to worship.
Worship daily, so I'ma leave it all right here.
Say my hands are raised, yeah.
Raised because I surrender.
I surrender, Jesus.
Your will is
what's best for me. And we trust you, God.
I worship you.
And we bow
before the King.
Oh, say no more, no more crying. No more complaining. Oh, we won't complain, God. Your word is true, yeah. Your word is true.
Lord, you promised never
to leave me. So here's what I'm gonna do, yeah. Come on, somebody say, I will trust you.
I will trust.
Trust you. God, I won't be afraid, but I'll give everything to you. God, I won't feel, but I'll give it all to you. I will put my trust in you. Somebody just type in trust. Come on. God, you didn't create us to worry. Oh, you have not given us the spirit of fear. Yeah, you created us to worship daily. Yeah, yeah. Come on, wherever you are, say, my hands are raised
because
I surrender. God, we surrender every worry, every worry, every anxiety. Because your will is what's best for me, God. Oh, God, I worship you. You're Jehovah Jireh. And we bow down because you're the King of Kings. Come on, stop your crying today. Say, no more crying. Hey, we won't complain today, but we will give God praise in all things. Because we believe your word is true. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor the sea begs for bread. Hallelujah. So this is what I'm going to do. Yeah, yeah. Somebody say, I will trust. I will trust. Yes, I will. Yes, we will, God. Somebody put in, I will trust in you, Lord. Come on. If you're going to trust, then put your hearts on the screen. Come on. God, even when we can't trace you, we will trust you. Yes, I will put mine. Somebody declaring my trust. All my trust. All my trust in you. Say, you did not create me to worry. Say, you did not create me to fear. But you created me to worship daily. So I will leave it all right here. Say, I will trust. I will trust. Yes, I will. In you. I will trust you. Oh, even when I can't trace you, even when I don't understand, I will put my trust in you. 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 God, we thank you for allowing us, oh God, to have a place where we can put our trust in you. Come on, somebody put, I will trust him. I will trust him on the screen. We praise your name, Lord God.
This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. How blessed are we today to be here celebrating another day with life, but not just a day of life, but as a church and ministry, we celebrate our second year anniversary. And oh, how much do we have to be thankful for? For God has been benevolent, God has been gracious. He has been a God who has restored and strengthened and done amazing things, and still will yet able to say, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it entered into the hearts of man what God has in store for us. Good morning to all of you, River of Life family and friends. We thank you for tuning in online to worship with us. If you have not done so already, we encourage you to start a watch party so that we can celebrate and spread the gospel of Jesus Christ and the love of God with as many people as we can, particularly in this season. There are so many who have questions that they are wrestling with, and they do not seem to have answers. But we, those of us who are the redeemed, we believe that the answer is found in God. In God, we find the strength and the stamina to make it through every life situation. This morning, I want to start a new series entitled The Fear Factor. The Fear Factor. And in episode one, I want to talk about a response to fear. The fear factor. As a youth growing up, one of the most exciting days of the week for me was Saturday. Because Saturday, my friends and I all met at the skating rink. Well, in order for me to make it to the skating rink, I needed some money. And so I would normally get up early in the morning between 3 a.m. and 3:30 a.m. and I would go down to a little convenience store by the name of Bob Casey, located in Fort Pierce, Florida. And that is where you would load up to go to the tomato field. Some of you probably don't know what tomato fields are, what orange groves are. You don't live in those cities or towns, but in Fort Pierce, I grew up in a little agriculture country where we picked fruit and tomatoes and a whole lot of other things. But I needed to go to the tomato field so that I can get my money to go to the skating rink. And on Friday evenings, I would always invite my brother to go with me, and he always declined all of my invitations. I have two brothers, so I won't tell y'all the one that I'm talking about is Maurice. But Maurice would never accept any of my invitations to go to the tomato field or the orange grove or the bean field. But Saturday morning, I got up. One Saturday morning, I went to Bob Case's store, as I normally do, and I got lucky, I got blessed, and the man allowed me to go to work with him. And I picked tomatoes all day in the brutal hot sun. And when I came home, I took my money and I hid my money. I put my money in a place that I thought it would be safe, that I thought no one would find it. I put it there where I took a shower. And if you have to really understand the tomato picking experience to understand some of the things that I'm saying. But by the time you finish picking tomatoes, your hands had changed to the color green. And so you got in the shower, and it would take you sometimes an hour in the shower just scrubbing and washing and rewashing your hands all over again to get the green stains off your hand. Well, I'm in the shower and I'm washing, and I think I was in there about an hour trying to get the green stains from working in the brutal sun of the tomato field. And when I came out of the shower and I dressed myself, I went to the place that I had put my money that I worked with all day in the hot tomato field. And when I went into my secret place, my private place, what I thought was a safe place to get my money, I found a note. It was a note from my brother. I got two brothers. I won't say their names, but I'm talking about the one named Maurice. He had taken some of my money and left me a note saying, I borrowed $5. Well, all of us know that wasn't really borrowing. That was stealing. He had went into my place that I thought was a private place, a secret place, a place that I can put things in that no one else would be able to find and get to, and he had stole $5 of my dollars. What's the point of my story? The point of the story that I want to suggest to you this morning is that all of us need a place where we can put things. All of us need a safe place where we can put the issues of life, the problems of life. All of us need a place that we can go to and we can take our problems and our burdens and all of the things that life gives us to deal with and to handle, and know that it is a safe place, and that when you put it there, it is safe, and that you can rest and you can lower your anxiety because of the place that you have put it in. This morning, as we embark in this new series called The Fear Factor, the question that I have for you is, where do you put your fear? Where do you put your anxiety? Where do you put the things that brings a problematic distress to your life? Where do you put the things that keep you awake at night and make you afraid and make you weary? Where do you put the things that cause tears to stream down your cheeks and questions to run rampantly over and over through your mind, looking for answers that no one can answer and cannot seem to be found anywhere? Where this morning, I believe that our text is tailored to teach us that there is a place that we can put our fears. This text this morning is tailored to teach us that fear is a reality. Michael Welch says that fear is a prime experience and emotion that all of us live with, and we have it as a human being. But fear is sneaky, because fear can lay dormant, fear can lay passively in the background, but then there are times when fear can come boldly and show its face strong and roar in our life like a lion. Where do you put your fears? Where are your fears now? Because right now, as we look at the season that we're in, this very strange season, this coronavirus season, there are people who are experiencing fear in everywhere, on every level. This pandemic is not biased. This pandemic is not prejudice. It has reached the man and the woman who sits on the highest hill. It has reached the man and the woman who sits in the lowest valley. It has reached every social class, every gender, every race. And right now, when you look around the world, when you turn on the news, when you go on social media, when you listen to the radio, what you hear is repeatedly fears, words of fears, postings of fears, people wondering, what am I going to do? Fear is real. And somebody this morning knows what I'm talking about, because you're wrestling with fear right now. You're dealing with fear right now. Fear not only for your life, but for your livelihood. The fear that has been brought to you and put on your doorstep because you no longer have a job. You no longer have health care. Fear of going outside and contracting the disease that there is no cure. Fear for those who fight on the front line, our medical people, and they're fighting like soldiers all day and all night, and many of them have not gotten relief. Many of them are fighting without sufficient supplies and resources. Fear for a loved one, fear for your business, fear for your children that you have that live in a different place and you can't get to. And yes, FaceTiming is fine and Zooming is fine, but you long for the opportunity to be able to wrap your arms around them, and you don't know if you will be able to wrap your arms around them once again. Fear for the loved one who is in the hospital, who is in the nursing home, and you cannot go see, you cannot go in touch. But this text this morning is tailored to give us hope, and David here teaches us how we can respond properly to fear, the fear factor, and a proper response. David says in this Psalm 56, he says, and I want to zoom your focus in this morning on verse 3, David says, when I am afraid, I put my trust in you. David here is on the run. He is on the run from King Saul, whose heart has become so hardened that he tracks David like a hound tracks a rabbit. David, who has been kind, who has been generous, who has been benevolent towards Saul, but Saul's jealousy rages out of control, has caused David now to be the enemy of one who he has sought to try to bring peace into his life. And David is on the run from Saul, but the story gets more interesting because he chooses a strange place to seek refuge in. The text says, the psalm says that he's on the run from Saul and he chooses to hide in Gath. Well, why is that word Gath important? That word Gath is important is because Gath is the city that Goliath came from. Gath is the city where the Philistines reside. And so David, you got to get this picture, is running from Saul, the king of Israel, and he finds a place to hide, but the place that he hides is a place that is occupied by all of his enemies. And so David has double trouble that he's talking about, that he's dealing with. He has double fears that is confronting him, that's on his doorstep. But in the midst of all of his fears and all that he's dealing with, David says something profound. David says something that ought to give you and I hope. David says something that should make you get up this morning in spite of the fear that you're dealing with and anxiety that you're holding in your hands. David says something that tells us that there is a response that every believer, that every child of God has. And when we exercise that response, something wonderful, something magnificent happens. What is that response? David says, when I am afraid, I put my trust in you. Here's David having a conversation with God. He's having a conversation with his creator. He's having a conversation with Jehovah Jireh, who provides Jehovah Yahweh, Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah Peace. David says, I'm in a place, a strange place, and it is causing me to experience fear, and I need to do something with it. And what does he do with it? He says, I put it in you, Lord. Well, the question this morning is, when do you put your trust in God? I'm glad you asked. This text suggests that the right time and the proper time to put your faith in God, your trust in God, is when you have a win moment. Win, hold on to that word. Win, grab hold to that word. Win, wrap your arms around that word. That word win is an expression of time. What David is saying is, he says, I'm having a moment. I'm having a win moment. And some of you know what I'm talking about because you're having a win moment right now. A win moment comes, and it comes often without giving you an advance notice. A win moment comes. It comes in all type of ways. It comes unexpectedly. It comes in strange packaging. When moments comes, if you don't know what a win moment is a moment of trouble, a time of distress, a time in which you have something laid and placed on your shoulders that is more than you can bear. A win moment is when you receive a bad doctor's report. A win moment is when you receive a call in the midnight hour. A win moment is when you get a pink slip. A win moment is when your income dry up. All of the world is experiencing a win moment. And so since we're in a win moment right now, David suggests that this is a good time, a great time, a wonderful time to put our trust in God. How are you handling your win moments? In 2016, in September on Labor Day, Claudette Campbell had a win moment. She was sitting at home enjoying a peaceful day. And then she saw two cars pull up in her driveway. They were cars that was both packed. She looked out the window and there was her family members. There was her niece and nephew. She got excited. Some of them she hadn't seen in a while. She opened the door and let them come in. She was elated. She was excited. The family had arrived. Family had come over to visit. But then she discovered something very quickly, that no one had smiles on their face. No one was happy. Everybody's countenance seems to be down. And she asked the question, what's wrong? And then one of them said, Denzel is gone. And then another one said, Dwight is gone. Denzel was her grandson. Dwight was her grandson's father. And she described that moment as being a wind moment in which her body was froze, her mind was froze, her emotion was froze. And for 15 seconds, she says, life seemed to be still. But in the midst of that stillness, in the midst of that frozen moment, in the midst of her wind moment, in the midst of feeling anxiety and fear, scratching and clawing to enter into her mind and her body and her soul, she said after about 15 minutes of seconds of silence, she opened her mouth and said, Lord, give me peace. Oh, what she was doing in that wind moment was she was putting her trust in God. I understand what she meant. I got an understanding of that much clearer last night, because just last night, after having that conversation with her earlier in the day and listening to her describe her wind moment, last night about 12:32, my phone rung, and when I looked at the phone, I knew I was getting ready to have a win moment, because it was the wife of a friend of mine who's been fighting and struggling for his life, who's been on his sick bed, and I knew this was not a call that was going to be a good call. And when I answered the phone and said hello, she said what I thought she was going to say. She said what I anticipated. And when she finished speaking, I remembered what Claudette Campbell said to me. And after I hung up the phone, I repeated those words. I said those words to the Lord myself. Those very words she said after she experienced 15 seconds of silence. I said, Lord, give me peace. Are you in need of peace this morning? I believe a whole lot of us are. If you are, I want to suggest to you that in the midst of this wind moment, in the midst of all the trials you're going through, in the midst of all the tests you're going through, put your trust in God. David says, when? Oh, he's saying, whenever trials come, that is when I put my trust in God. Whenever I'm confronted with obstacles, I put my trust in God. Whenever my enemies come against me, I put my trust in God. Whenever life gets strange, I put my trust in God. River Life, you ought to know like nobody else knows that God is a good place to put your trust in, because we know what it's like to have a win moment. We know what it's like to wake up and all is gone, all is lost. We know what it's like to be hurt and broken, but in the midst of our hurt and our brokenness, we put our trust in God. And what we discovered, that whenever you have a win moment and you put your trust in God, God will give you that peace that only He's able to provide. God will stand up in you when you want to fall down. God will hold you up when you cannot hold yourself. God will comfort you when nobody else can comfort you. Notice that David, in the midst of his wind moment, he does not put his trust in men. He does not put his trust in chariots. And right now, everything that we thought we could trust, everything that we've put our trust in, it has taken a bow. It has taken a knee. The economy is on his knee. The stock market is on his knee. The jobs are on his knee. Materialism is on his knee. Everything that we thought we could trust has disappointed and let us down. But there is still one who is still standing strong. He has not been knocked off his throne. And if you have forgotten his name is Yahweh. His name is Jehovah Jireh. That is whom we put our trust in. A response to fear is to put your trust in God. When do you put your trust in God? When you have a win moment. David says, when? I'm afraid. I put my trust in God. Well, another question is, why do we put our trust in God? I believe that David puts his trust in God because David is clear about his history and his track record with God. Somebody getting ready to get your shout right now. You have to remember in the midst of win moments. You have to remember in the midst of testing, in the midst of trials and tribulation. You have to remember that God has not changed, that God is immutable, that his mercy has not changed, his glory has not changed, his power has not changed. Nothing, no aspect, no attribute, no part of God's character has diminished. And so you have to know that, and you have to remind yourself that, so that when you get fidgeted and you look and see everything around you changing and shifting and moving and seem to be dwindling and you feel yourself even drifting far, far from the peaceful shore of peace, you need to anchor yourself and anchor your soul in the reality that God is still God and that he's still able to do everything that he's promised, and he's still able to control everything. He holds the whole world in his hand. Everything seems to be out of control and nobody has answer. Nobody has a cure. But God has a cure for your fear. Your cure is to put your faith in him. David says, not only do I put my trust in God when I have a win moment, but the reason why I put my faith in God is because of the history. He's talking about his track record. What is the history that David has with God? What is so rich about this history that makes David comfortable and confident enough to put his fear into God? He says, when I am afraid, I put my trust in God. Don't you see that picture? Don't you see the imagery there? It is an image and picture of David bagging up, grabbing up all his fear, all of his anxiety, everything that causes him to be uneasy, everything that distresses his mind, everything that puzzles him and perplexes him. He bags it up and he says, I put it into you. I give it to you. Why? Because he had a track record with God. God has showed him that he is able to do what man cannot do. What was it that he did? While David was a shepherd in the fields, it was the Lord that kept him. It was the Lord that protected him from bears and lions. It was the Lord that, when God sent the prophet Samuel to his daddy's house to anoint the next king of Israel, and they had a big party and celebration, but they did not invite David. It was the Lord that says, I know what they look at, and we're looking at the outside. And because you don't look right on the outside, David, we won't invite you to the party. But what they did not know and what David discovered is that man looks on the outside, but God looks on the inside. And he knew that that little shepherd boy out there in the field had a heart after God's own heart, and that he was the one who would be the next king of Israel. And so even though it was his party that he didn't get invited to, God paused the party, made them go get David out of the field, brought him to the party, anointed him for the party, and they party that they thought was their party became David's party. But don't stop right there. That's not only the only history that David has with the Lord. Not only did he keep him as a shepherd, but when the evening came and David went to give his brothers some lunch on assignment from his daddy, and he heard a giant by the name of Goliath defying the God of Israel, and he saw all the soldiers of Israel fretting. David says, this is unacceptable. He says, I'll go down and I'll fight him. But guess what David discovered? He discovered that when he goes down, and he goes down with the Lord, that something different happens. He went down into that valley to fight that giant Goliath, and he walked up out of the valley with victory. Why? Because the Lord was with him. He learned that lesson. And some of us, we got to be careful that in the midst of our tears, in the midst of our turmoil, in the midst of our trouble, that we do not forget the history that we have with God, the track record that we have with God. I doubt that there are very many people that I'm talking to that's listening to the sound of my voice right now, that this is your first trial, that this is your first obstacle, that this is the first time you've been tested. You got a track record. You got some history with God. God has done something for you in the past. He's done something for you before. He's kept you before. He's brought you over before. He's brought you through before. He's brought you out before. In the times of testing and trouble, that's where you discover, do you just trust in God or do you trust God? Because there's a difference between trusting in God and trusting God. There's a whole lot of people who believe in God, and there's a whole lot of people who trust in God, but it's a different thing to trust God. To trust God is to stand on His everlasting word. To trust God is to turn on and wrap your arms around His eternal promise. David's track record, his experience, his walk, his journey with the Lord gave him strength for the present battle, for the present moment, for the present wrestle, for the present struggle. I want you to remember, I want you to reach back. Some of you will get your shout this morning from reaching back. Some of you will get your release this morning from reaching back. Some of you will get your deliverance this morning from reaching back. Some of you will get restored. Some of you will change your countenance this morning if you just reflect on the goodness of God and all that He's done for you. Let me say it another way. There's a thing called a FICO score. A FICO score is what banks use to decide how worthy you are and how strong you are when it comes to lending. It's three numbers they use. And if you have a low FICO score, nobody wants to trust you because they don't trust you can keep your promise. They don't trust you can fulfill the contract agreement. This FICO score is created from your past track record, your past behavior, how you have paid your bills and how you've kept your promises in the past. Well, let me tell you something about FICO scores. When it comes to men, most men don't have a very high FICO score. And even your best friend who you think have an okay FICO score, that there's some problems, there's some trials, there's some issues that will come in your life that your friend, your family member, your best buddy doesn't have a high enough FICO score that you are able to put your trust in him. Because the reason you put your trust in God, the reason you give your troubles and your fears to God is because you believe He has the character, He has the strength, He has the stamina, He has the dunamis, He has the ability to handle your problems and your fears. What's the point I'm trying to make? I'm trying to tell somebody this morning that God has a high FICO score. He can handle all of your problems. He can handle all of your tears. He can handle all of your fears. His FICO score is not just high. His FICO score is infinite. He never runs out of love. He's infinite in His power, infinite in His glory, infinite in His benevolence. In all His ways, He's mighty. In all of His ways, all His arms can reach further than you can ever think of, imagine. And He's able to reach you right where you are. He's able to reach you in your bedroom, reach you on the porch, reach you in your dining room, reach you at the table, wherever you are, wherever you're sitting, wherever you're standing. If I were you right now, I would do like David says. I would do like David does. I would take all of my fears and I would put them into the Lord. I would give them to God because His FICO score is high. And I don't know about you, I'm glad I serve a God who has a high FICO score. When I am afraid, I put my trust in you. Where do you put your fears? When should you put your trust in God? When you have a win moment. And all of us will have a win moment. If you haven't had one, just keep living. You have some moments that will test your faith. You have some moments that will test your theology, your philosophy, all of your paradigms of life. You have a moment that will push you to the edge. But what trusting God does is it keeps you from the edge, because the danger of being on the edge is you may be tempted to jump. And that's where many people are. And I'm trying my best this morning to talk you in off the edge. I'm trying to talk you in from the ledge. I'm trying to keep you from jumping. One songwriter said, "Don't push me because I'm close to the edge. I'm so close I'm about to lose my head." Well, if that's you this morning, come on back in. Don't jump. Don't throw the towel in. Don't give up yet. There is a place that you can put your fears. There is somebody you can give your phobias to. There is somebody you can give your anxiety to. And that somebody is the Lord. The David is talking about the Lord. "When I am afraid, I put my trust in you. I do it because of the track record that I have with you." But that's not the only reason. That's not the only question. When do you put your trust in the Lord? When you have a win moment. Why do you put your trust in the Lord? Because he has a high FICO score. But I got one more question to ask you. How do you put your trust in the Lord? The David says, "When I'm in trouble." When, that expression of time. David is using this personal pronoun because this thing is personal for David. David is giving his own personal testimony. He's not telling you what somebody else did. He's not telling you what he heard. He says, "When I," he's talking about himself. He's testifying. He's having a conversation with the Lord. He says, "I got my enemies on my track. They're tracking me like a hound. I got Saul. I got the Philistines. I'm in Gath, and there seems to be no safety nowhere. I can't go to the left, can't go to the right. My enemies are behind me and in front of me. But in this moment that I'm experiencing, I'm going to respond with faith, and my response is I put my trust in you." How do you put your faith and your trust in God? You've got to give it to him. You've got to take their fears. You've got to be intentional. You've got to give God what you have on you and ask God to give him what he has in him. In other words, you are able to make a transfer through prayer and meditation. You see, when you pray, you're giving it to the Lord. When you meditate, you wait for God to give you back what he needs to give you. He gives you back your peace. That's why you can't move too fast. You can't be too quick. Some people pray, get up, and go on. No. You need to pray, and in your praying, you say, "God, I give you my fear." Somebody need to do it right now while I'm talking, while I'm preaching this sermon. You need to say, "God, I'm giving you this anxiety. I'm giving you this fear. God, I don't have a job, but I'm giving you the fear. God, I don't know if I'm going to be able to work another week or a week from now, a month from now, but God, I'm giving it from you. God, I got anxiety. I got things running through my mind. I got thoughts running through my mind. I got emotions that's out of control that shakes me, and sometimes I don't feel good and I want to give up. God, I'm giving it to you." And after you finish praying and giving it to God, then you got to sit still and meditate and let God give you back what he has for you. Well, what is it that God gives you? He gives you his peace. He gives you that peace that surpasses all understanding. He gives you his strength. I've heard people say it, and I have a problem with this saying, but people say God won't put more on you than you can bear. Well, I don't agree with that statement, because I can tell you myself from my own personal life that there have been moments where I've had more put on me than Vernon can bear. But you know what I did? I put my trust in God. And that's how you have to do. That's what you have to do. You've got to put your trust in God. Let me see if I can help you get this here in your mind and in your soul, and then I'm going to leave you alone. Well, as a kid, I used to love watching wrestling. Every Saturday morning, I wanted to watch wrestling. After I completed my chores, I went and sat in front of the television to watch wrestling. And my favorite wrestler was Dusty Rhodes. Dusty Rhodes. And the events that I really loved was the tag team. And I used to like it when Dusty Rhodes and Wildfire Tommy Rich would tag team. And you don't know what a tag team match is. That's when you got two people on the same team. And they're going against their fight. fighting against a team on another side, but only one fighter can get in the ring at the same time. And so a lot of times Tommy Rich Wildfire would be in the ring and he would be fighting another opponent. Now Tommy wasn't as big and he wasn't as strong as Dusty. And so sometimes Tommy would get outmatched and Tommy would begin to experience defeat. But you know what Tommy would do? Tommy would begin to fight. Tommy would begin to struggle to make it back to his corner because he needed to tag up. That's why they call it tag team. And when he got close to the corner, he couldn't always make it all the way to the corner. What Tommy Wildfire Rich would do and what you got to do and what I encourage you to do and what David says he does is you've got to reach. That's what faith is. That's what trust is. You're reaching for the glory of God. You're reaching for the power of God. And Tommy Wildfire, he will reach, and when he will reach and he will tag Dusty, oh, when Big Dusty came in the ring, things changed. When Big Dusty came in the ring, he came in with the bionic elbow. He came in taking care of every problem. He came in defeating the enemy. He came in knocking down. I'm trying to tell you that you serve a God. He's bigger than Big Dusty, and he has a bionic elbow too, and he's able to defeat fear. He's able to defeat your anxiety. He's able to defeat all your problems. Everything that troubles you, give it to God. Let him hit it with his bionic elbow. Let him hit it with his strength. Let him hit it with all his might. Whatever you do this morning, don't you quit. Don't you throw the towel in. Be not dismayed. God is not finished with you. He will not let you be swallowed up by fear. Fear is real. It's a primal emotion that we all deal with. What should you do? What should be your response? David says, when I am afraid, I give my fears to God. When I'm afraid, I put my trust in you. Look at this picture. David is the subject. God is the object. Put is the verb. That's the grammatical structure of the sentence, of the verse. David says, when I am afraid, I put my trust in you. He says, God is the object that I believe in. He is the object that I trust in. He is the object that I hope in. He is the object that anchors my soul. He is the object that keeps me from drifting, that winds me in from off of the edge when I'm tempted to jump and I'm about to lose my head. He is the one that sustains my mind when it's running rapid and frantic with all type of crazy thoughts. He is the one. He is the one. The Lord. What are you doing with your fears? David teaches us in this transparent song that fear is a reality, and the proper response to fear is to put your trust in the Lord. That's the message for this morning. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning, but there is so much we fear right now. We fear life. We fear livelihood. We have fear for others. Jobs have been lost. Businesses have been lost. Again, This pandemic has reached to the highest hill and to the lowest valley. I want to encourage you this morning to put your trust in the Lord, to trust in God. You will not get all your questions answered. But here's one question I can't answer for you. God has not gone anywhere, and he has not left you. He's still walking with you. He's still by your side because he promised never to leave you nor to forsake you. This morning, if you're watching, you're tuning in, and you do not have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and you want to make a decision to follow Jesus this morning, the Bible says that if you put your faith, if you believe, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that the work that Jesus Christ did on Calvary's cross is sufficient for your sins, God will give you salvation. He will justify you, and he would impute his righteousness into your life. If that's you, all you have to do is pray the prayer and say, God, forgive me of my sins. Come into my life. I believe that you sent your son, Jesus Christ, to die for me, and that the work he did on Calvary's cross is sufficient. You pray that prayer, salvation would enter your heart on today. I want you, right where you are, to just pause and pray with me for a moment. There is so much that we need to pray for and so much we need to pray about. Take all of your fears. Reach right now. Give them to God right now. Our God, our Lord, our Savior, we thank you for who you are. We bless your name. You're holy, you're righteous, you're just. And God, right now, God, in this strange season, we give you our fears. And God, we pray that you would give us peace. Peace that calms our anxieties. Peace that settles our fears. We pray right now, God, that every need that is represented on this online platform, that you speak to it, that you address it. We pray right now, God, for those on the medical battlefield who are fighting courageously, that you would send help, that you would protect them. We pray, God, that you would bring forth out of your wisdom that you pour into man a cure and answer to this deadly disease. We pray for leadership, God, because they have so many decisions to make, and they're not easy decisions, but we pray that you would give them wisdom. We pray that they make these decisions not only with wisdom, but they would make them with hearts of compassion. We pray for our world. Lord, have mercy on us. God, put your peace in us. This is our prayer, and we pray it in the mighty and majestic name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Once again, we want to thank you for joining us on this online worship experience. Oh, how I wish we could have gathered together in the traditional way to celebrate this second year anniversary. But that time will come. But right now, we're still able to thank God because God is still good. We're still able to bless God because his benevolence has not faded away. I want to encourage you to continue to trust God, to continue to hope, to believe. I want to encourage you to also continue to use wisdom in all that you do and the decisions that you make. There is a virtue in fear. There is a good aspect of fear, and that is it warns us of danger. And so as we walk in faith, because walk in faith we must, be wise, protect yourself, protect others, because God has given us faith, and he's also given us a mind. I will be continually praying, my wife and I, for you and your families, and I ask that all believers around this world will join us in praying for God's mercy. That's what we need. For God's peace, that's what we need. Look forward to seeing you Tuesday, 7 p.m. in our Bible huddle. We'll be online by way of Facebook and Zoom, and we will have a rich discussion around this topic, the fear factor. Again, on behalf of myself and my wife, I want to say thank you. We love your River of Life. We love all of you who are what we call our honorary members and family members. You don't live here in the Treasure Coast, but you tune in and you join us and you worship us and you support us. We say thank you, and we're praying you'll strengthen the Lord as well. The fear factor, there is a response for it. Put your trust in God. Amen. God bless you. I see you Tuesday night, 7 p.m. in our online Bible huddle. Brother Trail, you come and take us out of here.
Come on, we will trust in the Lord until we die. Come on.
Oh, help me say, I will trust in the Lord. Oh, I will trust in the Lord. Oh, I will trust in the Lord. Until I die, until I die, hey, I will trust
in the Lord.
Yeah, I will trust in the Lord. Yes, I will trust in the Lord.
Somebody say, I will treat everybody right. Come on.
Treat everybody
right.
Hey, I will treat everybody. Hey, I'm gonna treat
everybody right.
Until I die.
Yes, I will treat
everybody right, y'all say, treat everybody right.
Till I die.
I'm gonna stay on the battlefield.
The battlefield.
Oh, I'm gonna stay on. Come what may, until I
die.
Till I die.
I'm gonna stay on
the battlefield.
on, we're going to take it home. Oh, I'm going to trust it.
I will
trust
in the Lord.
No matter what you're going through, just trust Him. Trust Him. Fear you have no residence here. I'm going to trust in the Lord till I die. God bless you. Have a blessed week.